Today we're going to show you the proper way to mount your ECU, as well as how to connect the main power and ground harness directly to the battery. When you open up the box, you'll find some instruction sheets. One of these will be printed on a brightly colored piece of paper. You'll want to read these instruction sheets and thoroughly understand them before proceeding. Failure to follow the guidelines in those instruction sheets can result in poor vehicle performance, as well as damage to the ECU. Damage caused by improper installation is not going to be covered under warranty. The next thing we need to do is find a suitable place to mount our ECU. So we're going to go take a look at our 68 dart today and find a good spot to mount that. All right, so we've got our 68 dart project and we need to find a suitable location to mount the ECU. The Holley ECUs can be mounted in the passenger compartment as well as in the engine bay. If you're going to mount it in the engine bay, it is important to make sure that you don't mount it too close to high heat sources, and you also want to make sure that you can route the harness away from moving parts that could possibly cause some damage. Since we've got the 68 dart, we've got a lot of real estate on our inner fender wells, and we've got some real estate really close to the battery. So we've done a little thought process on it, and we've decided that we want to go ahead and mount the ECU right here. Another good point to mention when you're mounting the ECU, if you're going to mount it on a vertical surface, even though the connectors are sealed, you always want to make sure that you mount it with the harness pointing down to make sure you don't have any moisture migration that could cause some corrosion. So we've gone ahead and we've lined out some masking tape, and this will serve two purposes. One will protect our paint finish. The other thing that it'll do is give us a good surface in order to mark our ECU mounting location. So we can take our ECU, temporarily put it back in place. Make sure that where we're going to mount it, we're going to have plenty of room not to obscure the mounting of the ECU harnesses. Take our Sharpie marker and we'll go ahead and pre-mark our bolt mounting locations. When you receive the Holley ECU in the packaging, there is some supplied hardware. There's some insulating grommets as well as nylon inserts that go through the body of the ECU that help keep it isolated from chassis ground, as well as some factory supplied stainless steel hardware for installation. It's important that you do not remove this hardware when you install the ECU, because you want to make sure that it floats and it's not touching a direct chassis ground. An alternative mounting method that you could utilize, some of these vibration isolator mounts, because they allow it to float. If you're going to utilize these, it would be okay to remove the hardware, because most of these will have a 1/4-20 thread, but if you're not going to use a mount that insulates the ECU from its mounting surface, it is very imperative to remember not to remove this hardware. Since we've got this marked where we're going to mount it, we're going to go ahead and drill some holes. When you go to drill the holes to install it, it's important that you make sure you don't have anything on the backside. You want to make sure that it's clear before you drill. The worst way to find out where your location of your heater core AC evaporator is one of these drill bits. So we've checked, we've made sure that it's clear, and we're going to go ahead and drill our holes. All right, so we've gone ahead and torqued our hardware down. ECU is mounted in a good solid location. Now we want to go ahead and connect our main ECU battery power and ground directly to the battery. Before you do that, it's a good time to take a look at what you've got and make sure that nothing needs attention. We look at our positive battery terminal here. We can see we've got some corrosion, and now's going to be an ideal time to address that. We're going to go ahead and replace that battery cable before we move on and hooking up the ECU. Go ahead and finish tightening up this new top post battery cable. To prevent future corrosion, I'm going to go ahead and put some adhesive line shrink tube on here as well. That way we don't have to worry about that corrosion showing up in the future. All right, we've got our ECU mounted. We've got our corroded battery terminal corrected. Now we're going to go ahead and line out putting in the main power harness. The supplied Holley power harness is 13 feet long, and it'll support most applications without the need to extend it. If you find that it's a little bit too short for your application, you need to extend it. You want to extend it with a 10 AWG 10 gauge wire or larger. In this case, well, we definitely don't have to worry about extending it. So we're going to go ahead and dress in our harness roughly, kind of get an idea where we want to go with it and make some final terminations. So go ahead and mount it in close. Line out here. I know this should give me enough room to work with to get it roughed in. I'm just going to go ahead and cut this. And then we'll come back in and finish up our terminations. We've got most of our connections completed. We've got one more to go, and we're going to finalize this ground connection. Holley's nice enough to supply us with some quality hardware. They give you a piece of shrink tube to help seal that connection, as well as a crimp connector. It's important when you're making these connections to use the right tools. When you're crimping connections, side cutters, pliers, channel locks, they're not the right tool. You want to use a proper crimping tool for the terminals that you're utilizing. We take a look at this tool. This tool is designed for both insulated and non-insulated terminals, and it's important that you use the one that's listed for bare, the non-insulated with the bump. When you crimp a connection, it's important to look at the connector first and see where the split is, and you always make sure that you saddle the split, meaning that we saddle the split and the bumped end is on the back side. Otherwise, when you crimp it, it'll separate the terminal and you won't get a proper crimp connection. So we're going to go ahead and crimp that now. Once we've completed our crimp, we're going to use the supplied shrink tube and our trusty heat gun again, and we're going to make sure this is sealed up. That looks pretty good. I'm just going to put a little bit, additional piece of shrink tube here on the loom to help keep that in place for me. It's a nice little touch to add that little extra piece of shrink. That'll help protect the end of the loom, help keep things from getting into it, and it just gives you a nice, clean, neat installation. We'll go ahead and attach this ground cable to the battery. Make sure everything's good and clean. Take a wrench, we're just going to go ahead and snug these up. As I've mentioned several times, it's real important to make sure that when you connect the ECU power and ground to the battery, that you actually connect it directly to the battery. You don't want to connect it to starter solenoids, kill switches, distribution lugs, or strips. If your battery's mounted in the trunk of the car, you want to make sure that you extend these cables directly back to the battery. You don't want to have a heavy gauge cable going from the battery to a distribution stud underneath the hood and connect it there.
Hey Tom, you keep talking about having to go directly to the battery. 12 volts is 12 volts, right?
Well, come on, we'll go explain to you why. So 12 volts is 12 volts, huh?
Well, sure.
Yeah, I got an exercise. 12 volts is 12 volts. Why don't we go back over to your dart and grab the coil wire, and I'll crank the car over. You tell me 12 volts is 12 volts.
Yeah, you're crazy.
So let's talk about transient voltage or flyback voltage. The reason that you don't want to hook up the ECU to a position different than the battery, it's the same reason you didn't want to grab that coil wire. So let's look at this. I'm not an artist, so you just have to bear with me. So we got a house. It's got two lightning rods on it that are cabled together. You're a little dude standing out here in your backyard. Lightning comes in, hits that lightning rod, travels across and goes down to the ground. What's going to happen to you standing out there in your backyard?
Well, nothing.
So let's make this a little bit more interesting. Let's grab your coil wire. So we take a wire and we run it up here. You're out there, you're grounded in your yard, and lightning comes in, hits that cable. What's going to happen to you?
I'm going to be extra crispy.
Everybody likes bacon, but we don't want to be bacon. So let's look at this a little bit differently. We take the little guy out of the equation. Now let's look at your Holley ECU. Got your Holley ECU, and it's grounded out. And the ECU is sitting out in the backyard, and lightning comes in and it hits. The ECU is just sitting out in the backyard like you're standing there. What's going to happen to the ECU?
Nothing.
Let's say we took and we run that power wire over to that lightning rod. What's going to happen to your ECU?
You're going to have a dead weight.
Yeah, you're going to have a brick. So let's look at this a little differently. A common thing is for people to mount the battery in the trunk. And then they run a heavy gauge wire up to a distribution lug, and that's where they tie everything together. So let's look at this a little bit. Starting to look a little bit more like something you may have in a vehicle. If you take the ECU and you follow the instructions and you isolate it directly to the battery acts as a big surge pressure like the earth does with lightning, And the transient flyback voltage, when it gets to the battery, it gets buffered out. It basically helps absorb it and dissipate it. If it's connected up here, without that, any flyback voltage or transients that occur in the vehicle's electrical system is going to hit whatever component's attached before it gets back here where it can balance out. So if we look at this like an automotive application, this would commonly be a kill switch. Maybe it's that distribution stud under the hood. And then you have a lot of high current devices in the vehicle that can cause load dumps or transients. Like common.
Cooling fan, maybe?
Cooling fans. Another real common one. Trans brake. What are some other high current devices that can give you some transient flyback or load dumps?
Starter solenoid.
Yeah, starter solenoid's pretty common. How about line locks?
Sure. What about nitrous solenoids?
Nitrous solenoids, as well as AC compressor clutches, are all high current devices that will commonly give you a high transient flyback voltage into the ECU. So if we were to take the house out of the equation, this would be a common type of installation you may see in a vehicle. By isolating it, you keep things that need to be clean separated. So if this stuff is clean, what do you think all of these connections are?
Dirty.
Dirty. And if you mix clean and dirty connections together, different electrical components, you're going to take out your ECU, and we definitely don't want to do that. Does that help make you understand why it's important to connect directly to the battery?
Definitely.
Yeah. Moving forward, would you hook an ECU or any other sensitive digital electronics to a place other than the battery?
No way.
Always read your instructions. I know we're a bunch of guys and we don't like to read instructions. When it comes to this type of equipment, it's okay to read the instructions. You don't have to tell your buddies you read the instructions, but it's okay to go ahead and read them. Let's go on over to the bench and look at a couple other things involved with installations.
Sounds good.
I want to discuss a couple other installation options that we haven't covered previously. We talked about mounting the ECU underneath the hood, but what we didn't talk about was if you're going to mount it in the passenger compartment. You can mount it in the passenger compartment, depending on where the battery is located. You will need to run your harness through a sheet metal firewall or bulkhead, and there's some precautions that you want to take in order to do that. Go ahead and grab our makeshift firewall. Show you guys a couple different types of grommet installations. First one I'm going to show you utilizes the Earl seals at grommets, which are a nice fire retardant rubber center with an aluminum outer shell that's set up with four mounting holes that can be easily mounted into your firewall or any other metallic bulkhead you're going through to help protect hoses as well as wires. They're available with different size holes as well as a unperforated hole that allows for custom applications. So we'll go ahead and install this now. In this case, I'm going to use some tech screws that are self-tapping screws. I've already drilled a couple basic pilot holes to aid in installation. One of the things you want to be conscientious of is if you do mount these, watch where your hardware is, especially if it's got sharp ends on it, like a sheet metal screw or these self-tapping screws, because you want to make sure that they don't interfere with anything on the backside where you mount it, as well as the wiring. You don't want to have the wiring going across the sharp end of a screw that can end up causing it to chafe and short out and cause you some troubles down the road. We'll go ahead and finish locking these in, and we'll give you guys a couple other options. So we've got the grommet fully installed. Allow us to take our wires, route them through, and then terminate them for our battery connections. Before I go ahead and put the ends on this, I want to show you guys another option, and that's going to be utilizing a conventional rubber grommet. When you drill a hole through the firewall, your fender, whatever you're going to be running it through, be conscientious about the hole that you drill. Make sure that it's not too small. You really don't want to cut grommets and try to make them fit. Get a grommet that fits the wire snug and fits the hole that you're putting it in. And be sure that you deburr the hole after you drill it because you don't want any sharp edges cutting through. We'll go ahead and install our grommet. And you want to make sure that it's fully seated on both sides, both inside and out. I like to usually run a screwdriver or something through it just to help make sure that it's in place. We'll go ahead and install our harness through the grommet. Now we can progress over to our battery connections. We covered a top post battery installation, our 68 Dart over there, but let's say your vehicle is equipped with a side post battery. How do you go about installing those? I've seen guys take and stack numerous terminals underneath bolts, existing battery connections, and it just looks like a big jumbled up mess. And that's really not the best way to go about that. You can readily get these battery extenders from any one of your local parts stores. They're specifically designed to replace your stock side post battery terminal bolt and give you a double-ended bolt that allows you to factory secure your battery cables and give you a nice convenient mounting location to add additional components and accessories. So we'll go ahead and install these in our battery and snug those up. In this case, we're dealing with a dual terminal battery that has top posts as well as side posts. And personally, this is really my preferred battery method for installation. It allows you to keep your high current devices separated from your clean digital electronics. So we'll go ahead and we'll install these cables real quick. I'll just go ahead and snug those down. And as you see, it gives you a nice clean mounting. You're not dealing with potential for resistance, extra corrosion. It just gives you a nice solid install, keeps things separated out. Here's a couple examples of some clean wiring that's ideal to see in a vehicle. In this case, we've got a mock-up of a battery. So we've got our top post battery terminals. We've got our positive and our ground. See, we've got some distribution studs, some distribution blocks, and you'll notice that the ECU power and ground go directly to the battery terminals that we've discussed already. They don't go to the starter solenoid, they don't go to any of the distribution blocks, they go right to the battery terminals for a nice clean installation. A lot of times when you're dealing with older vehicles, somebody's been into wiring a bunch. It's had aftermarket stereos, different lights, multiple repairs, and you may end up running into a situation where you open up the hood and it doesn't quite look like this, but instead, it looks a little bit more like this. If you open up the hood and you see wiring in there that's lined up like this, you see a bunch of old T-taps and just wires twisted together. Hopefully you don't see any wire nuts. Wire nuts is for houses. They're definitely not designed for cars. Got old corroded battery terminals, things that are stacked. This just isn't what you want to deal with for the foundation for your EFI system. The EFI system's base foundation, it starts with proper mounting of the ECU as well as proper battery connections are critical. If you don't have a solid foundation, everything else is just going to be downhill from there. If you follow some simple guidelines for clean wiring, proper ECU installation, proper connections directly to the battery, it'll ensure a trouble-free operation of your Holley EFI system for years to come. Thanks for watching. For more information on great Holley EFI products, go to Holley.com.